السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، we started last week Friday and Saturday talking about Surah Yusuf عليه الصلاة والسلام and the lessons that we learn and the فوائد, the benefits that we learn from the story of Prophet Yusuf عليه الصلاة والسلام. We mentioned some of these benefits as that the father, when he sees one of the children has a special talent and has a special advantage and something that he can build on that and he can improve that and make it like inshallah yani gets greater and greater, he can give or he can pay special attention to that child to make sure that he will reach his goal. That doesn't mean that we discriminate between the children, but we are, yani, we have to be just and fair between them. And as the Prophet ﷺ said to the father of Nu'man ibn Bashir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, "Taqu Allah wa adilu bayn awladikum," fear Allah and be just among your children. And he refused to be a witness over something that Nu'man wanted to grant to his son to the exclusion of his brothers and of the other children. And also, one of the benefits that we talked about was al-ru'ya al-saliha, the good vision or the good dream, and that what happened to Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and it was a reality. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said in his hadith, which is narrated by Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, anna al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam qala, al-ru'ya al-saliha juz'un min 46 juz'an min al-nubuwah, yani the good vision or the good dream is a part of one of 46 parts of the prophethood. And if we divide the prophethood into 46 parts or into 46 aspects, the good vision or the good dream will be one of those 46 aspects. Also, it is permissible for the person to hide the blessing that is given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if he is afraid that people are going to envy him for that blessing and to be jealous of him, and may like it might result in harm against this person. So it's allowed for him to not to talk about it. But if he feels secure and safe against that, and he knows that inshallah yeah, nothing is going to happen to him, and that will encourage other people to follow his track in being a pious and righteous person, and Allah will bestow the same or like more blessings on them like he had bestowed on this person, then there's no problem talking about it. Actually, is recommended, as Allah says in the Quran, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. Also, the one of the benefits that we talked about is that the shaitan interfered between the brothers and he incited some of them against each other. And this is one of the biggest and the most beloved action to the shaitan. The shaitan, the main goal of the shaitan is to make the people fight against each other and to put enmity and hatred amongst them and to make them enemies of one another. That's what he cares about, because that will be destroying the community in as a whole. Also, we talked about the justice between the children, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selects and chooses some of his people, and he gives them privileges and advantages. But everything that we have been given in this life is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we are granted blessing, it's a test from Allah. How we are going to conduct it, what we're going to do with it, are we going to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that? If something bad happens to us, it's also a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is testing our patience, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in his hadith, "عجباً لأمر المؤمن إن أمره كله خير وليس ذلك لأحد إلا للمؤمن إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Amazing is the situation of the believer, the Muslim, that." And this, yani, subhanAllah, he said, all his affairs are good. And this is not for anyone except for the true believer in Allah Azza wa Jal. If he is blessed with something good, he is thankful to Allah, and this is good for him. And if he is tested with any bad thing, he is also patient, and this is good for him. And yani in both situations, the Muslim, the person who is closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will get the privilege of being thankful to Allah or being patient over what he is what is happening to him. Now, one of the benefits from Surah Yusuf alayhi salam, and this is related to the ayah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ يَجْتَبِيكَ رَبُّكَ وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَى آلِ يَعْقُوبَ كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا عَلَى أَبَوَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. What we learn from this ayah? We learn from this ayah that it's very important for the family to be a good family, for the father and the mother, if they want their children to be good. And I'm not saying that as long as the father and the mother are good, so it's a guarantee for the children to be good. We have in the history of the human beings, for example, we have Prophet Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, and there's no one who is better than a prophet. And we see his wife, how she was against him. Prophet Lot alayhi salatu wasalam, and we see how his wife was against him. Prophet Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, and we see how his how his father, I mean his son, was against him and did not even want to board the ship with him. By the way, Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam said, "Ya bunay irkab ma'ana." He didn't even tell him, forget about the message now. We're not talking about the message. We're talking about just board the ship with us. You know, come with me, listen to your father, take the advice of your father. And he said, he refused. Sa'awi ila jabalin ya'asimuni min al-ma. I will climb over a high mountain that will protect me from the flood. Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, la 'asima al-yawma min amrillahi illa man rahim. No one will be safe today except the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant mercy, those who board the ship with Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. So anyway, what I want to say, if you look at the ayah, it says, وَكَذَلِكَ يَجْتَبِيكَ رَبُّكَ وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ وَيُتِمُّ. Thus, your Lord will select you, will choose you, and he will teach you the interpretation of the dreams, يُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ, and he will complete his favors upon you as he completed upon your parents or your grandparents, Ibrahim and Ishaq, كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا عَلَى أَبَوَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. So what we learn from this ayah is Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is saying to his son Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, see the lineage, see your father and your grandfather and your grandfather. If we're talking from Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, the father of the prophets, and then Ishaq, the grandfather of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he was also a prophet, and Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, a son of a prophet, and he was a prophet, and also Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he was a prophet. So we're talking a chain of prophethood. So here Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is reminding his son Yusuf by telling him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will choose you and teach you the interpretation of the narratives and complete his favor upon you and upon the family of Yaqub, which is the children of Yaqub, as he completed it upon your fathers before Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and Ishaq. Indeed, your Lord is knowing and is all wise. So we learn from this ayah, subhanallah, yani the good origin, the good lineage, the good parents will have more impact and more effect on their children. And that's what we need to learn in our life, that it's very important for the parents, if they want their children to be good, they need to be role model. They need to be good examples for them. Someone might come with an argument saying that we know such and such family, the father is really good, the mother is really good, but the children or some of the children are not acting properly. I will say we are responsible before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the efforts. We are not responsible for the results. This is very important to understand. يعني when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us on the day of judgment and asks us about our responsibility towards our kids, He's not going to ask us whether our kids were righteous, pious, were good, or were not good. No, He will ask us, what did you do for your kids? Yes, we can spend so much time with our children. And by the end of the day, maybe some of them will not be behaving properly. Is it our fault? No, it's not our fault. It's maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يعني decrees something for this person. Maybe this person does not want to listen. يعني we have the example in our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He could not guide his uncle, Abu Talib. And he said to him just to say it, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. And he did not say it. And by the end of the day, everyone is responsible for himself. So what is required from the Muslim is to do his and her job. Just we should do our job as far as sitting with our children, teaching them Quran, teaching them Islam, teaching them the Salah. And I'm sure that Allah promised in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرَ مَنْ أَحْسَنَ عَمَلًا. Allah will not waste the efforts of the one who is doing good. This is a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we should not just concentrate on the academic education and the academic level, the academic standard of our children, but we should also teach them the rules of the religion and the rules of Islam and the teachings of Islam. This is like a true story from someone who came to one imam, one sheikh of the masjid, and complained to him. He said, "Ya sheikh, ya imam, I have two children. I have two sons. I raised them and I spent too much money on their education. And one of them is a doctor and the other one is an engineer. And they are living their life and they don't even pick up the phone to call me. They don't even ask about me." So subhanAllah, the sheikh asked him, "Were you sitting with them and teaching them the Quran or Islam along with the academic education? You only cared about the academic education?" He said, "No, I was paying more attention to their future and what they intend to be. And I want him to be a doctor and I want him to be an engineer." There's nothing wrong with that. We should actually encourage our kids to get to the highest position as far as qualifications and education and everything. But in the meantime, we should make them connected on a daily basis with the Quran, even one ayah, one verse from the Quran every day. That is going to be, inshallah, a changer to their life. So that man told him, "You raised them for this dunya, and now they are the children of this dunya. You didn't raise them for the akhirah." I don't mean that we are going to sit with our children 24 hours and just dictate them the Quran and the hadith, but at least we have to make sure that they are connected on a daily basis, because subhanallah, the kids are very smart and they look at their parents and they see what they are doing and they imitate them. And in certain cases, they see, okay, my father never told me to pray, so why do I care about the prayer? I never see my father praying. Someone might say that. I never see my father praying. Someone might say, I never see my mother holding the Mus'haf or reading the Quran. I always see my father on his phone, my mother on her phone, and no one of them is talking to me about anything. So the point is, in order to have good children, the parents have to do some efforts, and they should make sure, they should not be frustrated if anything happens to it, if any of the children behaves in a bad way. Because this is not their fault. They are getting the reward anyway from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know that it is going to be perfect and it is going to be absolutely fantastic when they see good results in their children. This is something that each and every one of us is looking for. But let's do our job and ask Allah for guidance and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring the result. And let me also raise another point here. Sometimes when some of the parents are doing their job, teaching their children and trying to connect them with Islam, and they see their children are not listening, or they are behaving differently, or there is no like tangible result, and there is no like visible effect on them. So they sometimes give up. Never ever give up with the children. Children are waiting all the time for the point when the parents will give up and will say, I'm done with this. I'm not going to do it anymore. Never ever give up with the children. Keep it, keep doing it all the time. And I mean, keep reminding them. Allah says in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. When Allah talks about the believers, He said, that reminder will benefit the believers. ذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. So what we learn from this ayah, ayah number 6 in this surah, is that the good lineage, the good chain in the parenthood, in the person's fathers and grandfathers and mothers and grandmothers, subhanAllah, they will have more effect and more impact on that person. And you never know if that child like behaves wrong sometimes. One day, whatever we taught them, whatever we put in their head, whatever we put in their heart, it is going, inshallah ta'ala, to bring a result. So one day these kids, they are going to grow up, they are going to be wise. And we know like kids, how they behave during that teenage time and what they do, and sometimes they think that their parents are wrong and why they are dictating us to do this, I'm not going to listen, and blah blah blah, all these kind of things. We know all these kind of things, but subhanAllah, when they grow up and they start realizing the value of their parents and the importance of the life and the reality of the life, they will reevaluate the whole situation and they will make dua for us. They will make dua for us even if, like, after our death, they will say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our father and our mother. They used to teach us this and this and that. But if we did not teach them anything, what we are expecting from them to do for us or to say after we die? They will basically say that they didn't teach us anything. See, subhanAllah. So it's very important to have a good family. And in the meantime, this family will exert the effort to make their children good. And they should never give up by any means. Continue the education. Continue the advice. Have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the top of that, always, always make dua for the children. Yani, a Muslim is not supposed to make dua against himself, or against his wealth, or against his children. Some people, unfortunately, due to the ignorance, sometimes when something bad like happens to them, they wish for something bad, like, I mean, worse to happen, okay? Wallah, I ask you to cause me to die, or my child to such and such happened to him and to her. No, don't do that. Always make dua for them. Always pray for them. Ask Allah for their guidance. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith, he said, "La tad'u 'ala anfusikum wa la 'ala amwalikum wa la 'ala awladikum." Don't make dua against yourself, against your wealth, or against your children. It might be a time that the gates of the heavens are open and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept this supplication. And one of the things that we should remember is the dua or the supplication for or against the children is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the dua of the parents are always accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is also advice for the children to make sure that they make their parents happy with them and they do not anger them and they seek their happiness, because that is going to result in their supplication and their dua for them. So this is the one of the benefits that we learned today. We have to make sure that the house is good, so we will have a good result. If you have a good tree, you have good fruits. If you don't have a good tree, then, and this tree is fading and no water, nothing, don't expect anything from this tree. There has to be effort, there has to be action in order to get a good result from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We move to the next ayah, which is ayah number 7. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm going to, by the way, last time I recited the ayat from 1 to 6. Today, inshallah, I'm going to recite from 7 to 10. because like we're going to take يعني one part by one part. So remember the benefit that we talked about today, which is related to ayah number 6. We're taking again another ayat today, or number of the ayat from 7 to 10, inshallah. I'm going to read them, and if you can, inshallah ta'ala, yani, pay attention to the reading. So if anyone wants to memorize these ayat, inshallah, they will be easy for him and her to memorize. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد كان في يوسف وإخوته آيات للسائلين إذ قالوا ليوسف وأخوه أحب إلى أبينا منا ونحن عصبة إن أبانا لفي ضلال مبين اقتلوا يوسف أو اطرحوه أرضا يخل لكم وجه أبيكم وتكونوا من بعده قوما صالحين قال قائل منهم لا تقتلوا يوسف وألقوه في غيابة الجب يلتقطه بعض السيارة إن كنتم فاعلين. These ayat that we have today, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what it means. Certainly, were there in Joseph, in Yusuf and his brothers, signs for those who ask. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي يُوسُفَ وَإِخْوَتِهِ آيَاتٌ لِلسَّائِلِينَ. When they said, Yusuf and his brother are more beloved to our father than we. إِذْ قَالُوا لَيُوسُفُ وَأَخُوهُ أَحَبُّ إِلَىٰ أَبِينَا مِنَّا. While we are a clan, like we are bigger in number. Indeed, our father is in clear error. إِنَّ أَبَانَا لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Kill Yusuf or cast him out to another land. اقتلوا يوسف أو اطرحوه أرضا. The countenance of your father will then be only for you. Then he will have no one to pay more attention to. Then he will have to pay attention to the other kids. And you will be after that a righteous people. And they are planning to do something. We'll talk about that inshallah. They are planning to commit a crime, and then after the crime, they are planning to be good people. اقتلوا يوسف أو اطرحوه أرضا يخل لكم وجه أبيكم وتكونوا من بعده قوما صالحين. قال قائل منهم, one of them said, don't kill Yusuf. Don't kill him. Why do we have to kill him? But throw him into a bottom of the well. وألقوه في غيابة الجب. يعني throw him somewhere. So some of the travelers will pick him up. يلتقطه بعض السيارة إن كنتم فاعلين, if you would do something. So here, in these ayat, we see one of the things that we learn here, that jealousy is really, really bad. Jealousy and envy is really, really bad. الغيرة قد تدفع أصحابها إلى الإضرار والإيذاء للضرر بالآخرين وإلى إيذاء الآخرين. See the brothers of Yusuf عليه الصلاة والسلام, when they have jealousy against their brother, what they did, they planned to kill him, or at least to exile him, to send him somewhere, or to hide him somewhere, to throw him somewhere. See, subhanAllah, that's something that we need to get out of our hearts. And we need to understand that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, we should not be displeased with that. We should not look at other people with jealousy. You know, subhanAllah, we should not envy other people. We should not be jealous of what they have and say, why do they have this and I don't have it? If we look at ourselves and we look at all the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given us, they are like really, really amazing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us more than what we expect, more than what we ask for. And you can see so many other people that are less blessed than us. And they have, like, I mean, subhanAllah, some people, they have chronic diseases. Some people, they have like more problems on a daily basis, more issues, depression, sadness, and grief, and so many things going on. And if we look at all the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given us, yes, we should remember one thing, that this life is not about a punishment or a reward. This life is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to accept whatever is given to us with the pleasure. And we should not get jealous of anyone. See, jealousy and envy, when it comes among the brothers, it causes some of them to think of killing the other people. And that's what happened, you know, with between Qabil and Habil, Cain and Abel, the two sons of Adam, alayhi salatu wasalam, when Qabil got jealous of his brother and said, you know, I'm going to kill you. And he killed his brother. Subhanallah. So jealousy is really a bad disease, is really a major defect that should be cleaned and taken out of our heart. Yani, subhanAllah, I remember this story of this man who used to come to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, pray and leave. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sitting with his companions, and he said, a man from the people of Jannah, the dwellers of Jannah, will enter upon you right now. And this man entered, he came, made wudu, carried his shoes in his left hand, and he went, prayed, and then left. And then, second day, the Prophet ﷺ said the same thing. A man from the dwellers of Jannah will come, will appear right now. And the same man came. And the third day, he did the same thing. So, yani, one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, he said that Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, yani, went to the man or another companion, and he claimed that he has a problem with his father, spent some nights with this man to see exactly what is he doing extra, what are the extra things that he's doing, so he deserves the testimony of the Prophet ﷺ and the affirmation from the side of the Prophet ﷺ that he is one of the people of Jannah. And he didn't see him doing like really, really big things. Just the salah, sleeping, waking up for the fajr. And that's all about it. Seems that the man is a very simple man. He's not doing something extra. So subhanAllah, this is a companion of the Prophet ﷺ. At the end, he said to him, you know, I didn't have a problem between me and my father, but I wanted to see what are the extra actions that you're doing to deserve that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised you the 3 days consecutively. And he said, you are one of the people of Jannah. So I want to see what you're doing so I can do the same thing. The man said nothing except what you had seen. But when that companion was leaving, so the man called him and he said, you know, but there is one thing that I want you to know about. He said, once I put my head on the cushion, once I sleep, I don't carry in my heart anything against anyone. Subhanallah. That's the main quality. He said, this is, yani, that companion said to him, this is the thing that, yani, because of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given you this position, and it is not easy for everyone to do. Yes, it is not easy for everyone to do. Definitely, if I have a problem with somebody, and I will keep thinking of this problem, why did he say this to me? Why did he do this to me? But imagine this man, regardless of what happened the whole day, by the end of the day, he did not carry anything in his heart. So what happened with the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam? The jealousy pushed them to commit a major, major sin. And that major sin was to kill their brother. They planned to do that because of the jealousy. So we have to take it. We have to take this out of our heart. We have to clear our hearts. We have to. And this jealousy, subhanAllah, wallahi, the envy and the jealousy, they even make the person who is having them not at rest at all. This person is always suffering because he is not happy at all. because he is jealous of others. He is envying others. He is just looking at others. We should not be doing that. That's what happened from the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directs us not to do this. Now, another lesson that we learn from this, that jealousy can lead to major, major sins. And it can lead to something very serious. That's why it is very important for the Muslim to purify the heart from this disease, the disease of envy and jealousy. Another lesson that we learn from this ayah, if you look at the ayah number 9, in which the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam said, "Uqtulu Yusuf," kill Yusuf, "awtrahuhu ardan," or throw him like somewhere, "yakhlu lakum wajhu abikum," so the countenance of your father will be only for you, "watakunu min ba'dihi qawman salihin," then you will be righteous and good people after that. So what is the plan? The plan was, okay, they're going to kill Yusuf, and after killing Yusuf, or exiling Yusuf, and after killing Yusuf, they were going to repent. In other words, to make tawbah, or to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to ask Allah for forgiveness. This kind of tawbah, the ulama call it as the tawbah fasida, the corrupted tawbah. What is this corrupted tawbah? It's the tawbah that the person plans to do something and then to repent after that. يعني the good tawbah or the sincere tawbah, at-tawbah as-salihah, at-tawbah al-nasuh, is that kind of tawbah that I made a mistake, I committed the sin, I did something wrong, but now I am repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I did not plan to do something wrong and said, you know what? Okay, let me do it and then I repent. I mean, we're not playing game with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they said, تَبْيِيتُ التَّوْبَ قَبْلَ الذَّمْ تَوْبَ فَاسِدَ. يعني to make tawbah or to plan to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before committing the sin, this is invalid tawbah. It's not an acceptable tawbah. That's what the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam said. We're going to kill Yusuf, and then after killing Yusuf, we're going to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is invalid tawbah. And okay, someone plans to do something bad, and then after doing this bad thing, he plans to repent. How does this person know that he is going to repent? He doesn't even know. You know, subhanAllah. Some people actually fall in that trap. And this is something that we have to be aware of. Sometimes we are about to do something wrong and we say, you know what, I'm going to do it. And then after that, I will pray to rak'ah, I will repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will be a good person after that. How do I know? Maybe the shaitan will drag my feet like over and over, step by step, and eventually I will continue in that sin and that mistake, and I will get addicted to that. It's like the person who starts like maybe smoking, and he said, okay, just one cigarette, just to try it. And then after trying it, okay, another one. And then, okay, another one. Until he gets addicted to that, and someone gets into drugs or something, okay, let's just try it. And then gets addicted to that and cannot go back. There's no U-turn. So he has difficulty in abandoning or setting aside what he is doing. So that's why we should not by any means say, you know, I'm going to do that bad thing and I'm going to repent after that. There's, and who guarantees for us to live until we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So this is known as tawbah fasida, or the invalid tawbah, which cannot be accepted. The tawbah, the good tawbah, is the tawbah nasuh, the sincere one, about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا التَّوْبَةُ عَلَى اللَّهِ لِلَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ السُّوءَ بِجَهَالَةٍ ثُمَّ يَتُوبُونَ مِنْ قَرِيبٍ فَأُولَٰئِكَ يَتُوبُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, the tawbah, which will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the repentance, which will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that from the sin that is committed ignorantly from a person, and he realizes his mistakes, he understands that it was wrong to do that, then he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah accepted this repentance. Now, another question someone might ask, does it mean if even someone plans a sin, And then after committing the sin, he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his tawbah is sincere to Allah azza wa jal. Does it mean that Allah will not accept his tawbah? No, that's not the meaning of it. Allah will accept his tawbah because this person has a chance. He has a chance to make a valid and sincere and a good tawbah. But what we are talking about is the risk that the person is putting himself in. That sometimes we put ourselves in this risk and we say, yes, I'm going to do it, but I'm going to repent. And I'm not sure if that's going to happen or not. But still, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always opening the gates of his mercy. وَيَبْسُطُ يَدَهُ بِاللَّيْلِ لِيَتُوبَ مُسِيءُ النَّهَارِ وَيَبْسُطُ يَدَهُ بِالنَّهَارِ لِيَتُوبَ مُسِيءُ اللَّيْلِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extends his hand during the daytime, so those who commit sins during the nighttime will repent to him. And he extends his hand during the nighttime, so those who commit sins during the daytime will repent to him. Allah is the accepting of the repentance. We should never, ever get desperate of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should always repent to him. We should ask for his forgiveness. If I did something wrong, I prayed to rak'ah, I make wudu, prayed to rak'ah, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, determine not to go back to this sin, feel guilty about it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, azza wa jal, will forgive me. He says in the Quran, غَافِرِ الذَّنْبِ وَقَابِلِ التَّوْبِ شَدِيدِ الْعِقَابِ لِلطَّوْلِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ إِلَيْهِ الْمَصِيرِ. He's the forgiving of the sins, غَافِرِ الذَّنْبِ. He's the accepting of the repentance, قَابِلِ التَّوْبِ. He is the severe in the punishment, شديد العقاب للطول. He has the might and the power. لا إله إلا هو. There is no one worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إليه المصير. To him is the destination. We are all going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let me inshallah azza wa jal summarize what are the lessons, what are the benefits that we learned today from the ayat from number 7 up to number 10. The first lesson that we learned today is actually from number 6 up to number 10. The first lesson that we learned today is the good lineage, the good family, the good house will always result in something good, regardless if even there is an exception that came out of this house. That is just an exception to the rule, but basically always the good trees will bring out the good fruit. This is number one. Number two, jealousy is something that is really bad. It's a spiritual disease that infects the hearts of the people along with envy, and we should get rid of that. Otherwise, this jealousy and envy can or might push the person to do something wrong or to commit a sin, and it might get the person in trouble all the time and make him or her dissatisfied and displeased with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them. And the last lesson that we learned today was that we should always have good repentance, sincere repentance to Allah. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا تُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَوْبَةً نَصُوحًا. O believers, repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincere repentance. This is what we learned today from these ayat. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to benefit us from this and to make all of us from those who listen to the words and follow the best of them. Jazakumullah khairan. If anyone has any question, inshallah, you can send it or you can ask it, because we are going now, inshallah, for the salah. The adhan is very soon, within a few minutes. So we'll go for salat al-isha, inshallah ta'ala. So I'll just wait if anyone has any question. And by the way, these are like really great benefits, that there are more and more benefits that we will still learn from the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and Surah Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And maybe inshallah, we finish today up to ayah number 10. If we have a chance to memorize, it will be great. By the time we finish the explanation and the benefits of this surah that we learn from it, and the Muslim, alhamdulillah, is granted the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of memorizing this surah, it will be like really, really good. Good effort from the Muslim to memorize Surah Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So inshallah, if any question, otherwise we will conclude with the dua, inshallah ta'ala. Actually, it's time for the adhan. So I'm going to conclude with the dua. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-huda wal-tuqa wal-afafa wal-ghina wa min al-amali ma tarda bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk wal-asr inna al-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilus salihati wa tawasaw bil-haqqi wa tawasaw bis-sabr. See you tomorrow inshallah at the same time inshallah.
Jazakallah khair.
Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum assalam.